Hey guys, this is Boss Gaming Network, episode 9. I'm Dynamica, this is Dynamic. Alright, so today we are going to cover a few games. We are going to cover Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire, we're going to cover Super Mario 64, we're going to cover Rune Factory 4, and then...
We're also going to cover No Man's Sky DLC packs, which I did do a review for No Man's Sky. In episode 6, but a new update has come out, so now the game is like totally remade. I actually have a copy of it now, and it's a definite big positive change for No Man's Sky. There is literally no bad talk that can be done about this game at this very moment. Other than that, we'll be covering Child of Eden, Xbox 360, if everyone remembers that, and the Pokemon Ruby Sapphire as well. Mm-hmm. So,
I've got shit talk for No Man's Sky. But anyway, all right. So,
so you're saying that you still have bad things to say about No Man's Sky?
It's a crap game.
It's not a crap game.
It's a crap game.
It's good now. It's a good game now.
I don't believe this. I have trust issues.
Oh my god. Okay. All right. First game on the list.
Super Mario 64.
What happened? Every single okay, and she calls herself a boss sergeant. Okay, all right.
Okay. Anyway.
All right, Super Mario 64. So, what do you remember about that game?
Hold on, let me stop laughing.
I'm just like. It's like very elegant too. It's like, and you just looked at me like.
Wait, and then I just started laughing. Okay. Anyway. Okay, all right, so. Alright. Super Mario 64, developed by Nintendo.
It's me, Mario!
To ever have a 9.8 on IGN.
True.
He was surprised by that. I'm not.
I'm actually surprised because Super Mario 64 came out like over, 20 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it's like wow, it still holds a 9.8. I don't know. I just find that kind of, you know, surprising. It's a shock for me.
It's one of the first 3D games out there. It is one of my favorites. I will go back and just try to 100% it, collect all 120 stars. Each level, as far as, you know, the normal person might know, has 6 stars. This isn't true. It actually, every single level has 7 stars. Because if you get 100 coins, another star will appear. A bonus star that is not typically mentioned. I personally love this game. It has character. It has all the comic relief. But it just has the character, the element that just a lot of other games don't have. On the intro screen, you can actually straight up just start pulling on Mario's mustache and his, like, his hat and his eyebrows.
Oh, yeah, I do remember that.
Yeah!
I used to go on the intro screen and just kind of, like, mess around with Mario for a bit.
And then there's a sentiment of throwing the baby penguin off a cliff. But I guess we're not going to get into that. Hey, a lot of people have done it.
I never did that. I don't think I ever threw the penguin, baby penguin, off of the cliff.
Everybody does it!
Run!
Post in the comments about if you're guilty too, or if I'm the only one.
Yeah.
I would have to say that probably one of my favorite stars to get in Super Mario 64 is Chip Off Womp's Block, because that's more comic relief. The obnoxious noise that the Womps make whenever you hit them or whenever they try to hit you. Dynamic has a video showing an example. Just with all the character and everything going on, plus you also have the racing element at times, where you got the turtle shell and you just, you know, some of it's rigged. Like, there's an ice slide on Cool Cool Mountain. There's an ice slide, and that is rigged, and I had the hardest time. Like, I have almost rage quit a few times, just being like, what the?
Oh, wow.
But then finally I'll get it. But and then if you try to cheat, the game will catch you a lot of times, so you gotta cheat properly without getting caught. But anyway.
Wait, so you're telling me that the game can actually call you out for cheating?
Yes, they do. Yes, they seriously do. Hmm. I have done it before. I have hopped off the slide to a level below somehow, in order to finish the race. There's like a bit of a warp somewhere on the slide that I took once, and the penguin called me out.
Oh, yeah, I do remember that now in the races. Yeah, yeah.
I'm still salty about that, because doing it the normal way is the hard way.
Wow, interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Super Mario 64 was definitely a classic. I had a lot of fun playing that game when I was younger. I mean, it was one of those games where you kind of played it, and you're like, wow, this is 3D.
And the secret stars, too.
And the secret stars. You know, I didn't get, like, maybe 120. I think I earned, like, maybe 110.
Mm-hmm.
But
I got 119, but I forgot to get a secret star, and this is what makes me so mad.
Okay.
So, it was like, shoot, what was it? Like, the one where it's, you get 50 stars first. Yeah, because there's this one toad that you talk to after you get 50 stars, and then you also talk to him after you get 100, or, you know, it's somewhere along those lines. I believe it's 50 and 100.
Okay.
But anyway, I think I forgot to talk to him after I got 50, and I remember to talk to him after I got 100, so I missed a star. I had 119 stars. I am so mad about that, too. But,
yeah,
there's so much character, and there's also graphics and stuff that you don't really see in a lot of other games from that time.
Okay.
Like, there's actually one of the secret stars, or not one of the secret, but one of the more hidden, you know, areas of the game. You're actually running up, and there's like a portrait of Peach, right?
Okay.
And you're about to run up, and I guess go jump into the painting or whatever, like you do all the other paintings, right?
Right.
As you run up, her face randomly morphs into Bowser,
and
then suddenly the floor opens up, and you just like shoot, and then it turns out it's Bowser's slide.
Yeah, it was a trick. I think I remember that. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's just like the effect of Peach turning into Bowser.
Yeah.
You don't see that at all.
That's true. I mean, yeah, it was definitely ahead of its time. I was impressed by Super Mario 64, personally.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great game.
Yeah, like, it was and is one of my favorites. Like, I might actually go play it pretty much right now after Fellman, because I love this 64. Game.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man.
I personally, some people are going to hate me for this, but I personally do prefer Mario to Zelda.
Really?
Judge me.
Wow.
I still love Zelda, don't get me wrong. But if I have to pick between the two, Mario.
I mean, I just find Zelda more interesting than Princess Peach.
3, 2, 1, go!
Than Princess Peach, but you got the character, the comic relief, and all that, that, you know, you don't necessarily have as much in The Legend of Zelda games.
But Zelda was an elf.
3, 2, 1, go!
Italian plumber. Like, he's just got a mustache. It just works out.
Wait, we go with Mario 64 over Zelda because of the mustache. Right there.
No, because of the comic relief, the character, the fact that this game was basically ahead of its time when it came to the graphics.
Hmm.
I'd say, you could argue a pretty ahead of its time, you know, at least to some extent.
Hmm.
You know, it was groundbreaking. It paved the way, you know, when it came to graphics. It set a new bar.
It was awesome.
That needed to be set.
It was awesome. It was a great game. I loved Mario 64.
10 stars.
Mario. What would be the rating on Dynamica?
10.
10?
10.
Okay. All right.
It's not getting a 9.5 out of me. It gets a 10.
Oh, no. It's a good game. Still one of the best, I think, that was ever created by Nintendo. So,
10.
Okay, awesome. All right, guys.
Bam!
What was that? I didn't even say anything. I was just about to go into the next game, and then Boss Sergeant Dynamic hit me with one of her military-trained attacks. Where did you learn that from? I didn't teach you that one.
I learned that on my own.
Personal training. Okay. All right. We're off subject. Okay, guys. So, we're going into the next game for the Boss Gaming Network Episode 9. This game was groundbreaking, but it also upset a lot of, I should say, players when it first released. I talked about this game before, but here it is again, No Man's Sky. Come on, do it with me. Come on, let's do it. Let's make it again. In the cat. You're like Cat Peach.
Okay. I don't do this.
Okay. All right, so, No Man's Sky.
I prayed. Never.
What?
I didn't know that.
All right, guys, we got some remedial training here, right? We'll be back in like 10 minutes. stand by. Sky, PS4, new DLC drop. Love this game. Already said before, this game was phenomenal, insane, awesome, beautiful. This is one of the best open world space explorer games that ever released in history.
Welcome to No Man's Sky version 1.75 Visions. Exotic new worlds make exploration more exciting than ever. Collect rare artifacts as trophies of alien worlds. Raid from procedural crashed freighters. Encounter bizarre and otherworldly new life forms. Debris and alien technology can be salvaged and sold, whilst existing planets are more vibrant, varied, and colorful. Archaeologists can unearth remains of ancient life forms. Community missions now share progress globally. Visual enhancements include improved skies and atmospherics. Survive extreme climates to collect precious new materials. Celebrate events with new constructible fireworks. Visions is an important step in the No Man's Sky journey. More will follow.
A graphic generator, which basically creates graphical detail in the game consistently on its own. So everybody's game is not quite the same, but now they've added a feature, or Sean Murray, the leader of Hello Games, has just now introduced new DLC to where now players can play with each other. And this is awesome because this was the only thing the game missed. One thing I will say about open world games, whenever developers promise a game to have multiplayer before it released, and it's anticipated, like how No Man's Sky was, the game released and never had multiplayer. People hated this. People were so upset with Sean Murray. They were like, man, I spent $60 on a game that was worth $15. And I totally agreed. I had the game when it first released. I pre-ordered it. And no multiplayer. It was a very repetitive game. You basically just flew from planet to planet, collecting alien technology and history facts. And then the game would just restart. And you'll start from the very beginning. So as you can see, that upset a lot of people. But now it's changed. Now you can actually purchase space stations, have other players come land in your space stations, pay you to use your space station. You'll make money that way as a commander of a space station. You also now have the ability to build houses, like in Subnautica. In Subnautica, you have the ability to put panels together and build underwater homes. Now, No Man's Sky offers that same exact feature, which also gave it a big up, big boost. Now, not only just that, there's vehicles you can actually get now in No Man's Sky. Also, you can create fire squads or teams to where you can run with your friends and literally just do your missions together to try and find out what's at the center of the universe. Yeah, so I played last week with three new friends I met in No Man's Sky on PS4, and it was a beautiful time. Like, it was climatic. Probably one of the best experiences I had in gaming in a very long time. Now, what I want to do for No Man's Sky, because just for the DLC add-on, I've already did the game itself in Episode 6 of Boss Gaming Network. But in this episode, Episode 9, I want to give No Man's Sky a rating of 9.5. It doesn't get the 10.
Good.
What do you mean good? I mean, it was like an 8 before, so it literally went up a whole point and a half because of the DLC add-on.
See, I'm just a hater for No Man's Sky. I'm just like listening to you, like.
Oh my god! You know, a lot of people are now like, you know, they're forgiving Sean Murray.
I'm unforgiving. But I mean, you know, maybe one of these days, maybe I won't be so judgmental of this game that I am judging very harshly. And maybe I'll actually give it a few minutes of my time and see if I'm wrong.
Well, okay, one thing. If I'm not mistaken, you play Steam on PC, right?
Yes.
Okay, Dynamica. I know for a fact that you like Subnautica. Subnautica is one of your favorite titles.
I love Subnautica.
Of course you do. I love it as well. It's a beautiful game, right? It's phenomenal. Outstanding. So what I want to say is this. If you had a game just like Subnautica, but you were in space and you can travel from universe to universe, and each universe is different, it's not the same. Friends, multiplayer. Subnautica does not have multiplayer.
I'm not into the multiplayer element.
You did say that before. I remember now.
However, the rest of this sounds alright. As long as they don't mess it up this time.
Yeah, I'm hoping so. There is, you know, games, once they get DLC, they're consistently being updated, like, literally, like, every other day. You just don't know it. Like, if your PS4... or your PC, or your Xbox, or your Nintendo Switch, all your games that are online capable, all update consistently, like every 2 or 3 days. People don't even realize this. But hopefully it stays good. They don't update one day and mess up what they have going right now. But yeah, No Man's Sky, guys. Boss rating, 9.5.
Maybe one day I'll give it a shot.
One day.
You had to reset the camera, right? So now, Rune Factory.
Yeah, I kind of ran through that, but that's because I didn't really have to explain the game. I already did a review on it.
Yeah.
I was just talking about DLC. But I like how I incorporated the Subnautica thing, which it really is like that. Right. And it just kind of came to me, and that was, like, perfect. I was like, damn, that thought came at the right exact time.
Yeah.
That was a good review on the DLC. Then now I feel better because I felt bad about the review I did for it in Episode 6. I was like, damn, I killed No Man's Sky. I was like... But yeah. I really did play it last week and met three new friends.
Real? Alright guys, the next game we're going to cover is Rune Factory 4. It is personally one of my favorites. It is for the Nintendo 3DS or 2DS, just whichever the case might be.
Keep it, that is a
It is actually super, super good. One of my favorites, top notch. It also has that character, that wit, that personality overall to the game. Basically what happens first is your character is on an airship, and they basically get in a fight with pirates that pop out of the crates, right? And then your character gets amnesia, gets hit, and falls in a Salfia, the location for the game, the world. They fall, they land on top of Dragon's head. Dragon turns out to be pretty nice, and it just goes from there. They are introduced to, you know, their house. They're given a house. They're given, well, room. They're given a farm to tend to, take care of. It's like Harvest Moon, Fantasy Harvest Moon. So they farm, they harvest what's called runes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Just a whole lot of stuff happens. You can take care of monsters, you can fight, you can adventure, you can farm, you can craft, you can upgrade your weapons, you can do all of that. You gotta fight a bunch of monsters, there's a whole bunch of bosses, there is a strategy to beat each boss that you want to figure out. Maybe certain weapons that are more helpful, everything like that. There's a monster that kind of suspiciously resembles a cow. That you can tame in order to get milk and, you know, all that. Yeah, yeah, it's like Harvest Moon. I think they call it a buffamoo. The monster, yeah. It's not really a monster, that one.
That sounds
and then
funny.
There's like an apple thing that just drops apples.
Wow.
And then there's one called Cockadoodle that's like a chicken. But there's a place, if you walk into the right place, it's called a giant cluck-cluck nest. And, basically, it's a giant chicken that will one-hit knockout, you know, like, if it's like a rabid giant chicken out of nowhere. and it'll be like BAM, and then suddenly you'll be dead.
This just sounds like one of those crazy like J anime shows that comes on, and like you're just like, what? Like, what's going on here?
There's a lot of sense of humor about the garden and tool, the hoe.
Stop.
Seriously? Yeah.
Wait, who made this game?
Neverland. But it's great, and it's anime. It's kind of anime theme. Oh, and you can also, you have to get, like, a big bed first. You have to upgrade from the small bed. You have to upgrade.
Oh, wow.
And okay. then you can get a wife or husband, as the case may be. So
that's pretty cool. And Neverland were the developers of this game?
Yeah. And it's just a really good game. It's one of my favorites. Lots of adventures, lots of quests, boss battles. It's a good deal. I love it. Like, it's one of my favorites, and when I play it, I will play for hours.
Awesome. So, this game was developed by Neverland. This is called, Rune?
Rune Factory 4.
Rune Factory 4.
And Rune Factory, the OG, is top-notch, too, but I'll cover that on a later date.
Wait, what console was Rune Factory on?
Rune Factory was Nintendo DS. Rune Factory 4 is 3DS.
You sure didn't know something else? I think I remember that game being on something else.
That was a different game. Now, there's Rune Factory. It's a series. So you got Rune Factory 1, 2, 3, 4, right?
Okay.
For the DS series. But there was Tides of Destiny or something.
Okay.
There have been Rune Factory games, like series or games in the franchise that have been on the Wii. And then I think there was one on the PS3, too.
That's pretty cool. What about Steam?
No.
No. Okay. Cool. I remember there being
closest you get on Steam is Stardew Valley, but that's not by Neverland.
Oh, it's sort of like a breakoff from what Rune would be.
It's similar. Stardew Valley disappointed me though, but I will cover that at a later date. Rune Factory 4, I would say easily. Actually, I sound really lenient on the reviews today, guys. But really, I'm just covering some of my favorite games, so can I give it like a 9.8?
Whoa! 9.8!
If I can't do that, I'll make it a 10. No. Fuck it, I'm gonna make it a 10.
God. Alright, so you wanna give a 10.
Rune Factory 4, a 10. And man. I will hate on some games in some future episodes, I swear, I promise.
Well, the sergeant.
We're gonna have some ones. We're gonna have some zeros coming.
Zeros?
Yes.
That's even more. Just don't even acknowledge the game. Like, all right, we're gonna cover. Never mind. Okay, next.
For example, that's my rating for No Man's Sky.
Oh,
zero.
I'm gonna just bring it on No Man's Sky like that.
Zero. I'm a hater.
Wow. Well, all right, guys. Seems like the sergeant is very generous today on Boss Gaming Network. So that's a 10 for two games in a row.
I like the games.
Wow, boss rating.
10.
Damn. Wow, I'm actually shocked that you gave Rune Factory a 10.
Oh, look, I'm giving No Man's Sky a 0.
That's messed up. Oh, okay.
Look, I am a hater, but that is their motivation to do better.
Wow, okay, alright.
Don't fuck up next time, guys.
But they did do good, though. What do you mean? They fixed it. They fixed everything.
Too late.
Oh, okay. All right, guys. You heard the review. So, 10 for Rune Factory 4.
Yep.
Okay. Our next game. Okay, for episode 9. This is a game that was groundbreaking. The musical set tones in this game was some of the best I ever heard. This game was created by a Japanese company.
Q Development.
Yes. So the development team for Child of Eden, their team is called Q Development, and they did an awesome job, phenomenal, great, outstanding performance with musical set tones in this game for Xbox 360. Now, the best part about Child of Eden was that the game was based on music. Graphics and overall eye-hand coordination of basically shooting different objects going past the screen and coming towards you. One of the most memorable parts about Child of Eden is when you're actually following a blue whale and then it transforms into a phoenix. And you have to literally destroy the phoenix to make it to the next level. It's one of the most, I would say, visually great aspects about the game I've ever seen ever in my entire life when it comes to video gaming. was a game before Child of Eden by the same development team, Q, and it was called Rez. That's R-E-Z. That game was also just like Child of Eden, but it was the predecessor, and it was good, but Child of Eden does a way better job of just bringing you an environment of good music, good gameplay, and just overall visual aspects. The actual music is sung by the girl that you have to save within the game. I would say probably one of the greatest things about Child of Eden is the fact that there's a lot of unlockables. You can unlock more and more information about the game each time you do the best time or the best speed run on each level. Now, mind you, Child of Eden is not a huge game. It's literally only six levels. It's six levels, and each level has its own music. You can't unlock, like, special music videos and find out what happened, you know, how the girl, like, her world was destroyed, and you have to go in through the Matrix, because she's trapped in the Matrix, and that's what you're doing. Each level, you're breaking into the Matrix. You're basically unlocking parts of it to get closer to her, and, one... can die. So the thing is that you each time something is shot at you, you have to shoot it before it hits you. And that's how you play the game. You have to basically shoot every object you see plus projectiles coming at you. Once you do get to the end, they give you a little special ending, great music, all that, visual effects and everything. Great game. Love Child of Eden. With Kinect, if you never had Kinect before or actually played Kinect, this is back when this was on Xbox 360, you know, this game was fun with Kinect, because you could actually sit there and play the entire game with your hand. One hand was for rapid fire, the other hand was for bombs. So basically you would rapid fire with the left, and you would shoot with the right. So it's like a bunch of hand motions, and if anyone in your living room or your friends or family's watching you play, they're just like consumed with curiosity, like, what is this person doing? I mean, this game was awesome. I love Child of Eden. Okay, so if I wanted to give Child of Eden a rating, and I'm actually going to follow behind the sergeant on this one, and I'm going to give Child of Eden a rating of 10. And that's a boss rating. A boss rating of 10. This game deserves it. It was no other game like it on Xbox 360, besides Rez, of course, but same company developers, but best game for the Kinect, when the Kinect released it back on Xbox 360. So 10. Ball 3.
Alright, guys. So for the last game we're going to cover, we are going to cover not the Alpha and Omega versions, the old one. The classic Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire. So the starters are Treecko, Mudkip, and Torchic. Torchic is personally my favorite, and that's the one I always like to have as my starter. Because Blaziken is just so damn powerful when Torchic fully evolves. Double Kick was one of my favorite moves, so it was Blaze Kick. Sky Uppercut was pretty good.
Wait, now, Torchic, what did he look like? What kind of Pokemon was he?
He's a chicken! And he's a damn cute chicken, too.
Oh, yeah, Torchic, I remember now. Yeah, I about that guy.
And then he evolves an Okambuskin, a chicken with feet. And then you whoop some rock ass in Roxanne's gym, right? So okay. the rock gym, the first gym you come up to.
That's the very first one, right?
You beat her nose pass, which is up. A lot to deal with if you're dealing with another Pokemon. But if you get Torchic to turn into Combuskin, by the time you get to her gym, double kick that little motherfucker. Just double kick, get the potions ready, fucking double kick. You got into the bag, guys.
Okay.
You can get past that gym with a fire type because it will turn into a fighting type as well. And that is part of why I love Torchic.
Wow.
And cool. He can also learn Cut.
But Torchic, he's in Ruby, right?
Yeah, Ruby and Sapphire.
Ruby and Sapphire, okay.
So are Treecko and Mudkip. Some people really like Mudkip, they like the Swampert and stuff like that.
I mean,
you guys like Swampert, I like my Blaziken.
Mudkip wasn't really all that awesome, I thought.
And Treecko, yeah, and Treecko was the weakest link, I would argue. I mean, some people love Treecko, too. I mean, that's fine and dandy, but I mean, I burned that little motherfucker when with my Torchic.
Wait, so how many hours would you say, because that's one game I couldn't beat. I never could actually beat Pokemon. Like, I always get to, like, the last gym, and then it's like, you know, I'll just stop playing the game, but...
I would beat the Elite Four... And the champion. I always did that, and then sometimes a little, like, if there's quests or something. I got the Rayquaza, you know, in Ruby and Sapphire. Did I ever 100% the Pokédex? No. Guilty.
Oh, okay. Yeah. No, I never had either.
Yeah.
What about some of the legendary Pokémon? Like, let's say Mew. Mewtwo. Were these guys in...
He's not in Ruby and Sapphire.
What about Emerald?
I didn't play too much Emerald. I don't think so, though.
No? Okay.
But, Ruby and Sapphire, I mean, I would say Kyogre was my favorite of the legendaries of that. That was Sapphire, you know. Ruby was a Groudon.
Charmander was in Ruby, right? Charmander was in all of them.
Charmander wasn't in all of them.
No? I thought he was.
I didn't get Charmander in
What about Squirtle? Squirtle? No?
Wait, Squirtle?
The little water type Pokemon? Like a turtle? But he like shot water?
Yes, I believe I saw him in Ruby.
Mm-hmm. Those are the main ones. Pikachu, of course. Everyone remembers Pikachu from Pokemon.
Pikachu, Raichu. They loved using that on the bike trail, the bike path.
Yeah. I always thought Raichu was a good Pokemon, but it was something about Pikachu having that quick attack, and that was his biggest like advantage on like most of the Pokemon, really.
Mm-hmm.
More so than the electric attacks.
And there was a house. There's the mystery house or something, where with each gym badge, there's another challenge in it. I thought that was a pretty good little feature. And the secret bases, they actually made secret bases like a feature worth getting a bit more into in a Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire. You know, you could decorate and all that. You know, a lot more than you could. It's more interactive and the color helped.
Wow.
You know, like, I mean, you need the color. Like, the color just makes it so much nicer. And that's part of why I liked Ruby and Sapphire so much. It's like the pure sentiment. It's a damn good game.
Yeah, I mean, I always thought those games were some of the best, I would say, like, for Nintendo. You know, it's Pokemon games, you know, going to different gym to fight masters, and just having a little bit of story play out as well, too. And being able to just come across different Pokemon, you know, randomly. You never really knew what you were going to, like, come across and maybe even catch.
Yeah. Now, one of the things that a lot of people joke about Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire is your mom.
Oh, wait, I think I remember that.
So, Mom, I don't think she's really good. She loves staying in a truck. Rid out a seatbelt! I'm gonna fucking kill her. Yeah, it must be tiring riding with our things in the moving truck. Yes, it's fucking tired! Why are you doing this to me, Mom? Why can't I drive like you? Okay. So it's into the house.
And all the other Pokemon games, what's Mom do? She's just like, here, honey, have money, here, I will save your money for you. I love you so much. Have fun on your adventure. Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire, she shoves you in the back of the van at the beginning. You are in the moving truck. You're not seeing it up front. Nah, I think it's like a Machoke or something sitting up front. The Pokemon sits up front. You, on the other hand, in the back of the van with the boxes.
Yeah, that's kind of messed up, seeing that how, you know, I'm the trainer, and my Pokemon, who listens to my commands.
She put her 10-year-old...
That's crazy.
I could have a field day. I love it. Just Pokemon's funny. But it's just like, your mom, Pokemon.
Maybe the mom was like more of a Pokemon fan than her son was. I mean, he had to get it from somewhere, right?
Maybe. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire.
Yep.
Now, who were the developers for this game? Who made these games?
I swear. Same people who always make the game.
I knew that was going to happen. Oh my god, oh, we're going to miss something. Oh, there it is. Wait, just a second. Who were the developers for Pokemon?
Game Freak, as always.
Okay, so Game Freak, obviously. Game Freak also makes Doom, the classic shooting game that's been out for 2 decades plus. This is a great game, great shooting game. If you like gore and, like, monsters and shooting, like Resident Evil or that sort of nature, Doom is great for that. But, okay, back
Pokemon's
to
Pokemon's better.
Which one's better?
Pokemon's better.
A Pokemon is better?
Game Freak has built their entire thing. Okay, how many of you, put in the comments, how many of you have bought a Nintendo handheld system specifically to play Pokemon?
Well, I would probably think a lot of people, because it's like
It's why you buy your Game Boy. You don't just buy a Game Boy to buy in order to play.
Yeah, I can see that, but I would probably say people buy Nintendo for Mario. That's what I would think.
Oh, Wii, I'd say like the console, yeah. Mm. But handheld. You don't really play Mario so much on the 2DS, 3DS. You don't really play it so much on the DS. I mean, you can, but are you really buying that handheld system specifically for that? No. You're playing it for Pokemon. It just is how it be. Prove me right in the comments. Prove him wrong, please. Thank you. Please and thank you.
All right, so we'll say Pokemon. Pokemon is a huge game. It's classic. It's been out, you know, since I was a kid. I mean, since Game Boy all the way up to Nintendo Switch. So I definitely want to give Pokemon its props for being an awesome, incredible, inclusive, wonderful game that I've released on Nintendo consoles itself. Okay, so we're going to do a rating. And this will be between me and Dynamica. So Dynamica, I'll give my rating. Okay, Dynamica will give her rating, and then we're going to even it off in the middle, and that'll be the final rating for Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire.
Nine.
What?
Nine.
How do these games get such high ratings?
Flat nine.
And it's not even a newer Pokemon game.
It's an older one. It's a classic. It is a sentimental piece of my childhood.
Okay, Pokemon was a part of my childhood too. I will say that.
Nine.
So what year did Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire release? 2002?
I'd have to double check on that. Okay. It was released in Japan in 2002, and it was released in North America in 2003.
Oh, okay, so, all right. I guess I went off the Japan year, but 2003, like, I'll put something.
I was a kid.
There we go, okay. I was a kid.
I was in grade school.
I don't know. I think Pokemon has been out since, like, early 90s. Was it early 90s or mid-90s, the first one released?
I'd say sometime in the 90s. I'm not sure exactly. I mean, it started with a Pokemon Yellow, didn't it?
Yeah.
Was that the very first, or was that part of the first?
Yeah, Pokemon was great. Pokemon Red and Blue were the very first Pokemon games to release. This was in 1996, and Pokemon has been going strong ever since, with Ruby, Sapphire, Emerald.
XY, Omega, Ruby, Alpha, Sapphire, Sun, Moon.
Yeah.
Expanding even arguably in a go, if you really want to argue that as on the same tier, which I personally disagree, but I do like them all.
Yeah, they're all pretty good. I like them. You remember that Pokemon game that came out on Nintendo 64 where you literally had to, like, put, like, your little toy inside of a scanner, and it would plug into your 64, and then they would fight each other based off that? It was a card reader.
I know what you're talking about. I'm trying to remember the name.
Yeah. I mean, just off topic, I mean, we're talking about, you know, Ruby and Sapphire, but I do remember a game like that back in, I think, early 2000s.
Yeah.
Or the 90s, but...
And then remember how important Pokemon was to Super Smash Brothers, too. Yeah, Pikachu in there.
Yeah,
Blastoise.
Blastoise is in there, yeah.
There were a couple others, I think. Mewtwo, maybe? Or was that a mod? I don't know.
No, Mewtwo was in Smash Brothers.
Was he?
Yeah, he was in Smash Brothers.
Because I played a mod.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
I played a mod for Super Smash Brothers, like, a lot in college, and it, you know, I don't know exactly how much it might have been altered from the original.
Okay. Okay, guys, so, I'm gonna give, Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire a rating, and I wanna give Ruby and Sapphire a rating of 8, and that's a boss rating.
So, we're gonna leave this with an 8.5, I guess so. Okay, that's fine.
Oh, so wait, your rating again was...
Mine was 9, yours is 8, which means that rounds it off to 8.5.
Okay, so Pokemon, which actually I'm more happy with. I feel happier with that rating.
That's fine.
I always try and save, like, the best games, the best experiences for, like, you know, 9s and 9.5.
Like Super Mario 64.
Yeah, I can't
believe... Rune Factory 4.
Yeah. I can't believe IGN gave Mario 64... a 9.8. Like, I was looking at the review earlier today, just going over some games before the show, and I'm just like, wow, 9.8 for Super Mario 64?
Because it's good. It is a classic. It is one of the first 3D games that came out.
Yeah.
It set a bar for an entire generation of games. It set the bar for games to come.
Yeah, you're right. It did. It was one of those games that kind of came out and paved the way.
Yes, it was a groundbreaker. It put a clear division between, I'd say, just some of the original Super Marios and some of the games you play now.
Yeah.
Which game pushed things into 3D? Which things pushed things to eventually go toward like a?
I know GoldenEye was a big part of that. 007 GoldenEye was a lot of shooters were came mm-hmm. from that base game. So exactly. And that was also Nintendo. That was Nintendo 64.
Yeah.
Yeah, just like in episode 7, we Boss Sergeant Zelisa spoke about GoldenEye 007, and we spoke about how that intrigued the development team Bungie to create Halo.
Yeah.
So you see how far that went, and Halo's still going. Halo 6 is supposed to release soon, too. All my Halo fans out there. Will release maybe within the next year or two. We'll get some more information on it. Great game. Okay, all right, guys. So we're gonna go 8.5 Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire. 8.5 boss rating. Okay, so we're gonna close out right now. Thanks for joining us here. Me, Division Leader Dynamic 2839, and Boss Sergeant Dynamica.
And I am glad we got to cover everything today. You know, so many great games. I will have to hate on a few games, you know, on the next episode, but...
Well, you don't have to hate on a game.
Yeah, yes, I do.
Been very generous, but I mean...
I have been. And, you know, it's really not what I'm about. I've just been covering a lot of games that I truly love, that are near and dear to my heart. So next time, I'm going to cover some of the games I don't like.
Awesome.
And then we're going to be talking.
Cool.
All right, guys, sign up on the website. www.bossgaming.com.
Don't click 4 W's.
I did not. Okay. Alright, guys. Sign up on the website. Check it out. www.bossgaming.net.
Yeah.
Hey, guys. We also got an Instagram. Dynamic2829.
Nope. my name is Dynamic2829.
Bam! Alright, guys. Also, check out the Instagram. Dynamic 2839. Definitely worth a, you know. All right, guys, make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel. You know, we do videos, you know, just every time we can. Get your friends involved. Subscribe, subscribe, subscribe. This is Boss Gaming Network. I am Dynamica. Do not ever forget. Just seriously, seriously. I'm just serious. This is my plan. Hold on. Don't break the footage. Okay. All right. I am Dynamica. I will see you next time. Okay, guys. Okay, guys. I am Dynamica. Subscribe to the YouTube. Get your friends involved. Play your games. Drop a comment. Anyway, we will see you next time.